Hey everyone, it's DeathFromAbove and welcome back to the channel. And today, a little bit of a different introduction to the video because we are taking a look at my favorite battleship in the whole game, the Scharnhorst. And her sister ship, the Gneisenau. We'll talk about which one is best during the stats section. But my favorite is the Scharnhorst, and the reason why I absolutely love that ship, besides why it is absolutely beautiful with the Azure Lane camouflage, it's because of the playstyle. It's a very, very aggressive playstyle. You basically need to play that ship like a pirate ship, as if you were a pirate commander. And actually, if you think about it, if you look at the Azure Lane commander that you get within the camo package, she looks a bit like a pirate. If you look at her, she has that black thing on her eye. Well, big tits as well, so let's say that it's a pirate commander with big tits. But the whole spirit of these ships is best captured by the sentence, play this like a pirate ship. So as always, we'll be taking a look at their stats, a small focus on their commander, and I will have a couple of gameplays which are really exciting and really highlight the strengths of these two ships. So let's get started. So let's compare the two ships to a series of other tier 7 battleships, the premium Japanese Mutsu, which has torpedoes, the Ashitaka, which is classified as a battlecruiser, your average tier 7 battleship, the American Colorado, and the Duke of York, which you need to feature in a Scharnhorst video. For those who know history will know why, but the Duke of York was the ship that helped sink the Scharnhorst. So, survivability, it's average. The hit points, it's not very, very high. Citadel protection is a bit better. Damage reduction is also quite nice. But overall, those are real battle cruisers and they will not be able to withstand the same level of punishment as, for example, a Colorado. Where those ships start to shine is in the maneuverability department. The Scharnhorst and the Gneisenau get excellent top speed, excellent traverse, and excellent general maneuverability values, which I've chosen to improve. I've chosen to improve the turn time to be able that I'm able to flex all the time on the battleship, on the battlefield, and you will see that I'm turning and moving quite a lot with those ships during the gameplays. In any case, their maneuverability is certainly a lot higher than any other ship at tier 7. Unfortunately, their main guns are not excellent. The Scharnhorst gets 9 283mm guns, lowest caliber at tier 7, and the Gneisenau gets more acceptable 380mm guns, but it only gets 6 of them. So yeah, life sucks. At range with these two ships, your AP DPM is not excellent. 38,000, 44,000, those are the lowest values at the tier. And that's why I prefer the Scharnhorst, because the Gneisenau was absolutely abysmal DPM with its main guns. The range is also not excellent for the Scharnhorst, a bit better for the Gneisenau. But this is not a ship to be meant at long range anyway. And that's further highlighted by the rest of their statistics. You see that the secondaries are German. It means they're excellent. You get an excellent range of 7.2 with the Scharnhorst, 6.8 with the Gneisenau, and an excellent AP, DPM, that you might actually be able to reach of 25 and 28,000. So the Scharnhorst trades a little bit of DPM for range, well, it doesn't matter, but it's still much, much better than the other tier 7 battleships. They also get auto secondaries like any German battleship at higher tier, which add a nice 13 to 14,000 damage to your DPM, and they also get torpedoes, which further emphasizes the playstyle of these ships, that we are going to play like pirate ships. We are going to get really, really close to our enemies, and we are going to be completely obliterating them with our secondaries, our auto secondaries, and our torpedoes. And for that, we need to get within 5 kilometers to be adding a nice 10,000 burst damage to our DPM. So it's not a lot if you compare that to a destroyer or a cruiser, but still, it's a nice and welcome addition that allows you to make the most of short range engagements. And so if we summarize the DPM, do not play those ships at long range. Try to play them at short range where they excel. Finally, AA, it's good. It's okay, they can survive air attacks quite well. So what would a pirate ship be without a commander? Well, there is one specific commander that you absolutely need to get to play those two ships. And we're going to have a look at that right now. So quick commander focus before we go into the gameplays. The commander you absolutely want to use on those two ships is Franz von Hipper, and the reason is that it improves anything that has to be improved with those ships. Your turrets get damaged all the time, you get a bonus to repair time, you will be using your sonar a lot because you will be really really close to destroyers. For long range you have something to improve on your accuracy, which is absolutely shit. And then finally, the two most important, you get an improvement to your secondaries, which you will be using a lot, and an improvement to the penetration of your shells, which is super super useful on the Scharnhorst because of the lower caliber guns. So Franz von Hipper, if you need to get one commander and one ship, that's for this one. So let's have a look at the gameplays now. So gameplay number one, excellent matchup for either the Scharnhorst or the Gneisenau, because we are faced against tier 7 battleships and two of them are West Virginia, which are super super slow and huge targets. So our low accuracy won't matter much because those are simply impossible to miss, and we see that in the gameplay. So immediately I'm going to start by going wide. That ship is not your average battleship, in which you want to stay more or less at the center of the map and be able to direct the engagements. Here we're going to go wide immediately and play it a bit well, like a commerce raider. We'll see what we can find there as a target. One destroyer and one battleship going to sea. Usually there are a couple of cruisers there, so no luck this time. Let's see which one we can engage. I'm probably going to focus on the Lion because I'm not really worried about the destroyer. I can dodge torpedoes quite easily. I've got sonar and my secondaries can trash him without any problem. So voilà, there we go. 5 hits into the Lion using our precise aiming. The accuracy of those ships is absolutely awful, atrocious. These are not meant to be played at long range. I don't know how many times I will have to repeat this, but I see it all the time. People are staying at the back of the map with those two ships, and that is not how you play them. Absolutely not. Let's see if we can trash that Lion like a true pirate would do. So yeah, let's get close, let's see what we can do. I'm going to ignore that destroyer. I might take a couple of shots at him, but still, I'm going to leave it. My secondaries, they're only 10 degrees, so they take a lot of time to get on target, but once they're there, they hit really hard. That's already 9,000 damage dealt into the game, and we've already taken 4,000-5,000 hit points to that destroyer. But the main thing we're looking after is the Lion. We're going to get really really close to him and we're gonna be firing torpedoes, auto secondaries and our main guns, and we're going to be damaging him. And that's really what I mean by play it like a pirate ship. You get close to your enemies and you hit them with everything you get. You punch them in the face until they die, and that's what we do. Unfortunately, we missed the torpedoes, otherwise that Lion would have been dead a long time ago. But we can still hit them with our secondaries, auto secondaries, and we get full bent with our main guns. And basically that's the end of him. Bye bye Lion. And that's the first casualty of the game. And now I'm behind the other ships. And that's where it gets really interesting, and that's where the, I would say, commerce raider or pirate aspect gets into play, is we are behind the enemies, which are focusing on our series of other battleships, and we can hit them with, not with impunity, because this one is still looking at me, but he's going to lose focus quite soon, because he's been basically taken between two fires. My Colorado on one hand, and me on the other hand. But I'm not really interested in the West Virginia. I'm looking for something else, which is the Ranger, which is now completely unprotected. And I'm going to rush him, basically. So I'm going to really think like a pirate. Where is the ship with the least amount of protection that I can damage really easily? Well, the CV is not very far from these two battleships, so I'm going to engage him. Ah, voilà, there we go, here it is. And we're going to focus him and we're going to take him down in a couple of seconds. There you go, poor Ranger. We're turning towards him. We're going to... Oh, he's already in secondaries range, so that's really, really a bad place to be for him. And there we go. We get close, and as always, we're playing it like a pirate ship. We're going to get on board, and we're going to hit him with everything we've got. So main gun, secondaries, auto secondaries, torpedoes, the lot. He's going to get it all, and he will go down in probably 1 minute, less than a minute. There we go, that's the torpedoes, and we keep pumping damage into him with our secondaries. We're already at 50,000 damage into that game. And we've been able to use our super aggressive playstyle onto targets, and the game is basically over already. There we go, the three torpedoes are going to hit. And that poor ranger is gone in less than a minute. That's excellent. And now we can turn our attention to the two West Virginias, which are probably struggling with other things on their mind at the moment. I see that they're fighting with the destroyer, but still, let's try getting close to them. We're already in secondary's range. Let's see how many shells we can put into these two to finish the game. We're gonna use our secondaries to finish that West Virginia and to finish the game after 5 minutes. That was quite an easy game for the Scharnhorst. You see how we managed to always get close to our targets and to finish them using our secondaries and torpedoes. And that's going to be reflected into the final damage screen. So we get MVP and a couple of other medals, 75,000. Most important, 20,000 secondary battery damage and 10,000 torpedo damage. So that was an excellent example of pirate gameplay. And here's another one. Same story here. I'm going to go to see right at the beginning of the game. I'm not going to focus my attention to the center of the map, because again, you do not play that ship at range. You use it to flank. Use it to flank and use the maneuverability to get into a favorable situation. And this gameplay highlights that really well, as you will see. So here we are going to see, and for once I'm not alone, that's quite good. So let's see what we find at sea. Going with a cruiser and another battleship, so I have some support, that's excellent. I'm keeping up with the cruiser, no problem. I'm already at my top speed of 31 knots, so that is really, really excellent. I see that the rest of the enemy team has gone to A and B, so what am I gonna do? What am I going to find at C? there you go, that's one battleship already. Oof, and then actually half of the team has gone there. So that's going to be quite tricky. We're immediately going to turn back. We're not going to be engaging these into, into a range fight. I'm going to pump damage into that Fiji because he's right in front of me, throw torpedoes, etc. Make sure he cannot move. And I'll punch him while I can, but I'm immediately going to be running away. Because I'm not going to prevail in a standard, I would say, ranged battle with any battleship, even a tier 6 one, I'm going to suffer quite a lot. So I'm going to run away. Like any pirate would do, if you faced with a situation that you cannot win or you do not have an completely unreasonable advantage, you simply run away and you try to find another engagement, and that's what I'm gonna do. So yeah, while we're running away, we still keep focusing the ships, putting a couple of shells into that destroyer. And our speed allows us to get out of range of these battleships quite easily. That's really one of the main features of that ship. And the maneuverability is excellent for both the Scharnhorst and the Gneisenau, and you want to use that as much as possible. You see the reason why I've improved the turret rotation is already, and that's going to get even worse at the rest of the gameplay, but I'm going to be switching targets all the time. And you want your main guns and your secondaries to be on target as much as possible. So that's the reason why you want to improve your turret rotation with that ship. There you go, a couple of torpedoes to make him change direction. And we keep pumping damage into him. So we're already two ships down, that's not looking very good. My fleet got completely destroyed at sea. And I'm taking shells. The rest of the team is looking at me, so we kill that destroyer with our secondary, so that's good. And there I sense an opportunity. There is a destroyer next to this guy. He might not be really 100% focusing on me, so I'm going to turn around. The other ships are hidden behind mountains, so they cannot do anything to me. And I'm going to flex and punch that West Virginia in the face. There we go. Immediately, we're able to turn to get our full power into that guy, and he's taken down in a couple of seconds. That's already our second kill of the game. But we're certainly not going to stop there. That Fiji has been brave enough to follow us all the way, and now he's too far from the Arizona, so I'm going to turn around once again, and I'm going to punch him in the face again. So here we are, let's have a look. The Scharnhorst is an excellent cruiser hunter. Gneisenau a bit less because of Gneisenau is more efficient against battleships because of the bigger size of the gun. But there you go, he immediately starts running away, and I'm going to put some damage into him while he does so. And I'm basically going to pursue him. You're not getting away with this, Fiji. The main guns of the Scharnhorst are excellent against other cruisers, really. Look at that. Wow. And now I'm going to do the same to the Arizona. And that's where I get a little bit greedy. I will finish that buy-in first because it's appearing to my right. And he's not looking at me, so I can punch him for free. And I'm not going to worry about the Arizona immediately. I'm going to finish that buy-in first. I'm going to help my other battleship. So that's our third change of target in less than 2 minutes, I'm afraid. And there we are. Paf, that's it. End of the game for the Bayern. And now we can focus on the remaining Arizona. And here I'm going to try a... I'm going to be a bit greedy, so I'm going to hit him with my torpedoes, that's fine. I'm going to turn around him, and I am going to take some damage. That ship is not meant to go into a full broadside fight with battleships. And I don't know why, but I completely forget to... Well, basically repair my ship as soon as the cooldown finishes, and I will get taken down by the Arizona. But that shows how you can flex with the Scharnhorst. Basically, you can orientate the game the way you want to, and basically pick your targets and pick your fights quite easily. So this ship favors a very, very aggressive playstyle. So yeah, a little bit of frustration that I underestimated the speed of the Arizona, of overestimated my ability to finish him at close range. But nevertheless, an excellent gameplay. We finished MVP, and now it's time for the third one, which is a bit similar. Same story, we're still going to go to the flanks, and we're going to see what we can find there. And it's quite tempting to be playing that ship like a traditional battleship, and that's what I was doing originally, and then I remembered, no, you're in a Scharnhorst, you need to be careful. Scharnhorst, Gneisenau, those are not meant to be played on the front line. You should not be using it like, for example, a Roma or, I don't know, the North Carolina. Those are completely different ships, so immediately we're heading towards sea, and we're going to be using our guns to put shells into the flank of these ships that are focusing on my fleet at A and B. We are 7 hits into that Normandy, which has paper armor, and that's immediately going to give us quite some damage. And there I noticed something interesting. I noticed that Bayern is a bit behind his fleet, and I immediately think about, okay, let's get rid of him. I can punch him in the face without any problem, but unfortunately that destroyer is super, super quick and forces me to disengage. So I'm going to throw some torpedoes to put him in a different direction. I will be engaging him with my secondaries as well. Taken already half of his, more than half of his life. But I need to disengage, I need to run away so that Bayern gets some time off. But we will meet again, so don't worry. So, pirates run away from unfair fights. There we are, the torpedoes are gone. I can turn away, I can turn around, and now I can 1v1 that Bayern. He's at 8 kilometers, so that should not take too much time to get close to him. And hopefully that destroyer won't be too much worry anymore, since he's already shot his torpedoes. So we turn around, and we're going to close the distance with that Bayern. He's still shooting at me, that's fine. Actually, only with his front turrets, not the rear turrets are looking at somewhere else, I don't know, but I'm taking advantage of the situation, I'm going to close the gap. So as soon as I'm within 7 kilometers, I can start using my secondaries, and that's the end of him. Here we are. That's main guns. Quite close. There we are. And I'm engaging the destroyer who appears on my right, and I'm going to finish him with my secondaries, no problem. There we go. Bye bye, destroyer. Voilà. Now we can catch up that Bayer.
The situation is under control.
And there we are, second kill of the game. And what's left is a mediocre, poor, lonely cruiser. And those two ships are absolutely deadly against cruisers. So same story, you want to get as close as possible, but here we have to be a little bit careful because the Japanese cruiser have excellent torpedoes and he can take half of my life in one salvo without any problem. So let's use our precise aiming, let's put a couple of shells into him. There we are. So he's probably shot a couple of torpedoes, so I'm turning towards him to see that the torpedoes are going right in front of me, so that's fine, I'm dodging them no problem. And I can hit him with the main guns and the secondaries to finish the game. And there we are, that's another game with 3 kills. And another MVP medal for the Scharnhorst. And it's quite common with those two ships to have games with a relatively low amount of damage, but a high number of kills, because those ships are able to, well, they're somewhere between cruisers and battleships. They can move quite freely around the battlefield, they can pick their targets, pick their fights, and quickly finish off anything that's within 6 or 7 kilometers from them. And that's their main strength. That's also the reason why I prefer the Scharnhorst over the Gneisenau, because the Scharnhorst, the playstyle is the same, but the Scharnhorst further amplifies everything that is great about it. It's more aggressive, the guns rotate more quickly, the secondaries have a little bit more range, and the torpedoes as well, so it really, really exemplifies that pirate playstyle that I've been trying to show you. So as always guys, I hope you've enjoyed the video as much as I've enjoyed making it and playing those ships. I will be seeing you soon. In the meantime, stay safe, take care. That was Death from Above, signing out.